Alright guys, I welcome you to today's class. We'll be handling the specific heat capacity. So what is energy? Energy is the capacity to do work. It may exist in various forms. It can exist as potential, kinetic, thermal, electrical, nuclear or other forms of energy. Heat as a form of energy. So we shall concentrate on heat as a form of energy. Heat or thermal energy is the energy from the movement of atoms or molecule. It may be considered as energy relating to temperature. We cannot talk about heat energy without talking about temperature. So whenever there's a temperature rise, or whenever heat is added, there will be a rise in the temperature of a body. So let's see. Heat can do work. So how does it work? How can heat do work on a body? Alright, over here we have a pot of rice. We can see the steam or the foam leaving the pot, and you can see the cover of the pot is up. So we can notice that the cover of our pot at home while cooking rice boils up and down due to the vaporization of what? Of the steam. The steam causes the cover of the pot to move up and down, especially in the case where the rice in the pot is more than the actual quantity the pot can carry. So we can see when the quantity of the rice is much and the pot is small, you will see the cover of the pot moving up and down, as we can see here. Alright? So now, hence we can see that heat has done work. Heat capacity of a material. When heat is added to a body, the temperature rises, but when heat is removed or extracted from a body, the temperature of the body falls. So what is the significance? What does it mean that when heat is added to a body, the temperature rises, but when it is now removed or extracted, the temperature of the body falls? What's the significance? So, different substances respond to heat in different ways. We have an example. If an iron door is exposed to the sun on a very hot day, we observe that on touching the door, the hand will attest to the hotness of the door. So, on a hot day, you can expose your door to the sun, any door, let's say with the wooden door, and over time, when you touch the door, you discover it's very hot. It is very, very hot. But when you expose a wooden door of the same mass to the sun, you will tell that it will not absorb the much heat as compared to the iron door. So that's it. So different substances will respond to heat in different ways. So what does that imply? This implies that the wooden door has greater heat capacity. The wooden door has greater heat capacity, and hence the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of the wood by 1 Kelvin or 1 degree Celsius is greater than that required to raise the same mass of iron door. So that's the significance of the experiment, that the wood door has greater heat capacity. So that means it will take time for the wooden door to absorb heat as compared to the iron door that can absorb heat as quick as possible. And that's why it is hotter than the wooden door of the same mass exposed to the sun. Hence, we can now conclude that heat capacity, often abbreviated as CP, some persons might call it C, but I prefer using CP, is defined as the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of a given mass of a substance by 1 Celsius or 1 Kelvin, as the case might be. Mathematically, we have that the heat capacity CP is equal to C times M. With time, we'll see what the C represents. So the M is the mass of the body, right? So where C is the specific heat capacity of the body in joule per kilogram per Kelvin, and M is the mass of the body in kg. We'll still refer back to the specific heat capacity and see what it implies. Now, what is the unit of CP? You now have that CP is equal to, since specific heat capacity is in joule, we can substitute the unit, which is joule per kilogram per Kelvin, multiplied by the mass of the body, which is in kilogram. So kilogram will cancel kilogram. So we now have that CPE is equal to joule per kilogram. So that's the unit of the specific heat capacity. Now, let's now talk about the specific heat capacity of a body. It is observed experimentally that the quantity of heat Q received or supplied to a body is proportional to the mass and the temperature change. So the heat you can supply to a body is directly proportional to the quantity, to the mass of the body and the temperature change. The heat that a material can accept or reject is dependent on two things. One, the nature of the material making of the body, and two, the mass of the body. And we can see that the nature of the material making of the body, as we did in terms of we compared wooden door and iron door. So because of the nature of the material, the amount of heat that a body can accept or reject is dependent on the nature of the material. Also, it is dependent on the mass of the body. The more the mass, the more the heat required to raise the temperature of the body. So for instance, when you have 1 kg of wood, it will take a shorter time or a less heat to raise the temperature of 1 kg of wood as compared to 50 kg of wood. So the amount of heat it can accept is or reject is dependent on the mass of the body. So mathematically, so to represent the statement above, we can say that Q is directly proportional to the mass of the body and to the temperature change. So what's the temperature change? When the body was at T2, at T2 is the final temperature and T1 is the initial temperature of the body. Now, the alpha, which is the constant of proportionality, depends on the nature of the material that is accepting or rejecting heat. So C is the constant of proportionality. So what is C? This constant is called the specific heat capacity. So C is simply the specific heat capacity of a body, which depends on the nature of the material making of the body. Hence, we can say that Q is equal to C times M multiplied by the change in temperature. So therefore, we can conclude that the specific heat capacity of a substance is the quantity of heat required to raise the temperature of a unit mass, that's 1 kg of an object or substance, by 1 Kelvin or 1 degree Celsius. So we are seeing the difference between the two. This one deals with a unit mass of a substance or an object, while the heat capacity is dealing with the given mass or the entire mass of an object. So let's continue. So let's see the relationship between the quantity of heat, the specific heat capacity, the heat capacity, and the specific heat capacity of a body. Now recall that Q is directly proportional to the mass, and then to that is the change of temperature, that is the equation one. But we have that Cp that we seen earlier is C times M, and remember that C is the specific heat capacity of the body. So equation 1 can therefore be written as Q equal to Cp multiplied by the change in temperature, where Q is the heat supplied, Cp is the heat capacity, and T2 minus T1 is the temperature change. So that is the basic relationship between Q, Cp, and C. So let's see the specific capacity of some substance. So experimentally, some of these substances have determined their specific heat capacity. So we'll have a table. So that's a table of the different substances. We have aluminium having 900 joule per kilogram. We'll have the lead having 130 joule per kilogram per Kelvin. So these are some of the substances we'll be needing in our calculations, and these are their specific heat capacity. So through this, we can now determine the heat capacity of the substance. So let's see the sample calculations. Example 1. We are told to find the mass of copper block with heat capacity 50 joule per kilogram. So, they've given us the heat capacity of the body to be 50 joule per kilogram. Now, from the table, that's the table we saw earlier, copper is 400 joule per kilogram. We can refer to it, all right? So, copper is 400 joule per kilogram. Now, but Cp is C times M. So CP is 50 joule per kilogram, and our C, which is the heat capacity of the body, is 400. So multiply by the mass of the body. So we are looking for the mass of the body. There's an error here. This should be 400 and not 40. It should be 400. Alright. So we've corrected that. So now M will now give us 0.125. So the answer is correct. When you divide 50 by 400, 0, 0 cancels 0. You now have 5 over 40. And that gives us 0.125. So let's consider the next example. Hope is clear. So we just substitute the values they gave us to the formula Cp equal to C times M, because that's the relationship between heat capacity and specific heat capacity. Example 2. We are told to find the heat capacity of 5 kg of lead. They've given us the specific heat capacity of lead. We can also get it from the table. It's 130 joule per kilogram Kelvin. So now we still invoke our formula that Cp is equal to M times C. So at the end of the day, we will plug in our values, 5 kg multiplied by 130, and that will give us 650 joule per kilogram. Now let's see the difference between the specific heat capacity and the heat capacity of a body. It's important to see the difference between the two. So first, the specific heat capacity, this is the heat capacity and not the specific heat capacity. So we will need to interchange it. So let's cancel this. This is heat capacity and not specific. So you can just add this to the specific. This is the specific heat capacity. Sorry for that. That's the specific heat capacity. So that's it. So we said that heat capacity is the measure of a particular substance resistance to change its temperature upon supplied heat source. So heat capacity simply tells you the resistance of a body when you supply heat to it. You understand what is the resistance? Just like we saw in the wooden door and the iron door, we saw that the wooden door is resistant to heat. So no matter the heat you supply to it, it will be difficult for you to cause a change in the temperature of the body. So heat capacity is simply a measure of this resistance. So why the specific heat capacity is the amount of heat per unit mass required to raise the temperature by 1 degree Celsius. So this guy deals with just the unit mass. Next one. Heat capacity depends both on the substance. It's important to take note of this. It depends on the substance and the mass of the body. Depends on the substance and the mass of the body. So as we said earlier, more the mass of the body, more is the heat capacity. So as the mass increases, the heat capacity of the body increases. That means the resistance to heat increases as well. So you can say that interchangeably. So now, but for specific heat capacity, it does not depend on the mass of the body, but it is a property of the body. Yeah, just like we said, it depends on the nature of the material. So that's another difference between heat capacity and the specific heat capacity. Now, the amount of heat to change a substance is simply the amount of heat. That's your heat capacity by 1 Kelvin. But this is the heat needed to change 1 kg. Just take note of this. Entire mass and then 1 kg of a substance by 1 degree Celsius or by 1 Kelvin. Also, the formula, you can also include the formula as a difference. You can also include the formula as a difference between the two. So we know that Q, that's for your specific heat capacity. You know that CP is simply called is equal to C multiplied by M. That's multiplied by the mass of the body. But here we have that C is equal to Q divided by the change in temperature, Q over the mass of the body, then multiply by the change in temperature. It's also a big difference between the two, so you can actually quote the formula should in case you come across an exam where you are asked the difference between the two. You can easily state this. So that's for that. So these are the exercises. You can find time to go through them and to test yourself based on what you've learned so far. So thank you so much. You can send in your comments or questions to this email address. So thank you so much for watching. See you in the next class.